review video for cardiomyopathy topic. Now, when I'm speaking of cardiomyopathy, what is cardiomyopathy? Cardiomyopathy is nothing but it's a pathology associated with the cardiac muscle. So when I have a pathology associated with the cardiac muscle, what are the problems I can see? What are the types? That's the most important thing I'll be talking here, right? So when I'm speaking of types of cardiomyopathy, let's start with dilated cardiomyopathy. So we have something called dilated cardiomyopathy. The word itself says what happens, the heart ventricles is going to dilate. Now what happens when heart ventricles dilate? So when there's a dilation of the ventricle wall becomes thin. So ventricle wall becomes thin means what? The systolic function will not be achieved properly. So wherever there is a dilation of the ventricle cannot contract. So when ventricle cannot contract, what is going to happen? Systole. Systole means the contraction and pumping of the blood will not occur properly. So because of this condition, what will happen? This patient will have a decrease of ejection fraction. So dilated cardiomyopathy is such a condition where there is a decrease of ejection fraction. Along with the decrease of ejection fraction, what is happening? Ventricular wall is being thin and dilated like a balloon. Now when I'm speaking of dilated cardiomyopathy, what causes dilated cardiomyopathy? The most important factor for causative agent of dilated cardiomyopathy is alcohol. Apart from alcohol, we have other toxins. One of the important drug which you have to remember for your exams, that the drug name is doxorubicin. Doxorubicin is a chemotherapeutic agent that can cause dilated cardiomyopathy. So dilated cardiomyopathy, what are the key factors to remember? Point number one, dilation of the ventricle. Point number two, decrease of ejection fraction. Point number three, it's a type of systolic heart failure. Okay, so we are done with dilated cardiomyopathy. Let's go and I discuss about something called restrictive cardiomyopathy. So before speaking to restrictive cardiomyopathy, let's understand two functions. What are the two functions we need to understand in a heart? That is systole and diastole. So whenever there is a systole, the ventricles contract and the ejection of the blood occurs. But when I'm speaking of diastole, diastole is a duration during which ventricle relax. When ventricle relax, what will happen? The filling of the ventricle occurs. But if ventricle has to relax, means there should not be restriction, means there should not be difficulty for the ventricle to relax. Now what causes difficulty? So whenever we have some substances like amyloidosis, the disease like hemochromatosis, the diseases like sarcoidosis, during these diseases what happens? There are some abnormal substances which accumulates in the ventricular muscles. Once they accumulate in the ventricular muscle, what's gonna happen? It's a very simple thing that it will not allow ventricle to relax properly. When ventricle will not relax completely, what's gonna happen? The thing is, there is a diastolic failure because ventricle is not relaxing. So if diastolic failure occurs, means ventricle not relax completely, but what happens? The quantity of blood which filled in the ventricle decreases. Pay attention, quantity decreases, but ventricle can contract properly. Whatever blood is filled, from that the quantity of blood ejected will be normal. So by this logic, look at this, it's a simple thing. The quantity which filled into the ventricle is less, but whatever quantity which filled into the ventricle, that will be ejected. So ejection fraction will remain normal or even be increased in the restrictive cardiomyopathy. But the only problem here is what? The only problem is it is a diastolic heart failure. Now what happens? The key points to remember from the diastolic heart failure, that is restrictive cardiomyopathy, that includes diastolic heart failure, increase our normal ejection fraction. So this is about the restrictive cardiomyopathy. So we have one more cardiomyopathy, that is called as hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. Now hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, always we think that ventricle might undergo hypertrophy, but please do not confuse. In a hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, what happens? Interventricular septum will start to getting hypertrophed. When there is a interventricular septal hypertrophy, what will happen? This hypertrophed septum will press the outlet of the aorta. Once aortic outlet is pressed, means the blood will not enter into the aorta, leading to zero ejection fraction or a cardiac output that causes sudden death. The most important thing about hypertrophic cardiomyopathy is that it is a disease. If you have any findings or because of any cause you did an echo and you found, for example, thick interventricular septum, you can do something. But if there is something like the patient don't know the existing factor, that means the patient might die when he does a physical activity. Because when he does a physical activity, what's gonna happen? The quantity of blood will be decreased due to dehydration. When there is a decrease of dehydration, decrease of blood in the ventricle, what will happen? It will just press the aortic outlet and cause the zero cardiac output. So what is the diagnosis method for the any cardiomyopathy? The most important diagnostic method for any cardiomyopathy is by doing an echocardiogram. So echo is an ultrasound scan which we do for the heart, and that's how we diagnose. Based on finding what type of cardiomyopathy we have a different treatment. Now, especially for example, dilated cardiomyopathy, we try using inotropic drugs such as digoxin can be used. So this is a cardiomyopathy.